Hello everyone, welcome to the video lecture. This is our third lecture where we are talking about thinkers, and this time we'll be dealing with Emile Durkheim. So Emile Durkheim basically goes down in the history of sociology as a functionalist as well as a positivist. So as a functionalist, he saw utility in all the various social organs. Later on, we'll be seeing that how he saw even utility in rate of crime. As a positivist, he wanted to see objective nature of social sciences. By objective, we mean wherein you can have loads of data, loads of figures, and basically minimizing the element of subjectivity. This, however, later we'll see, also became the bone of contention among his peers, who criticized him for overanalyzing sociology and then drifting it towards natural sciences. So we'll largely be talking about, in coherence with the UPSC syllabus, about social facts to begin with. According to Durkheim, social facts form the subject matter of sociology. So what is social facts? Social facts basically are those facts which happen to have a bearing in society. So according to him, there are basically two types of social facts: normal or functional and dysfunctional or anomic. So according to him, rate of crime is a functional fact because it tells the society that there is something wrong with it and it needs to rectify its measures. But when this rate of crime becomes soaring high, or let's say high rate of crime, it becomes a dysfunctional or an anomic fact. It shows that there is a deviance from the normal or the required behavior. Furthermore, for a fact to become a social fact, according to Durkheim, it must satisfy three conditions. First, externality. This means that the fact should be external to us. It should not be something with our personal behavior or our personal upbringing, our values, etc. Secondly, it should be a generality. So it should not be something like it's different for me and it's different for you or it's different for X. It should be homogeneous and affecting each one of us in the same way. Lastly, it exercises a constraint on us. Now let us say if there is a high rate of crime in the city, you would be forced to stay back in your houses once the lights are out. So it actually constrains your behavior, it restricts you to some things. So if a fact satisfies these conditions and of course has a bearing on the society, it qualifies as a social fact. Our personal behaviors, etc., do not qualify as social facts. Now this social facts basically highlights one of the important theories that Durkheim is very well known for. He uses the Latin word sui generis, S-U-I space G-E-N-E-R-I-S. So it's basically a Latin phrase which means that I am itself. It basically means, in Durkheim's reference, he says that it is not the individual who makes up the society. The society exists on its own. That is why Durkheim is credited with the fact that he gave very less importance to individualism. According to him, the society is of more importance than the individual. He gave the concept of moral individualism in social facts. According to moral individualism, a person should let go his own interest in order to protect the collective interest of society. So moral individualism is also seen as one of the theorems, as one of the propounded theories of Durkheim, through which he tried to say that when there is anomy in the society, when there is deviation in the society, you can actually resort to moral individualism and bring things back on track. Furthermore, he also sees moral individualism as a way to further bring things back on track. Now, as a functionalist, he of course sees utility in everything. So here also he tries to prove that an individual only will have an utility once he is a part of the bigger system. This theories about social facts are mentioned in one of his books, Rules of Sociological Method. Make sure you take a note of it, because if you're writing off about it and you're explaining that according to Durkheim, social facts are the subject matter of sociology, it will be really good if you substantiate it with the name of the book. So after having explained sui generi and the various types of it, there is bound to be some, I would say, some kind of criticism from the fraternity. So in this, basically there are two type of criticism that Durkheim has to face. First one came from Nicholas Timashev. Nicholas said that Durkheim is completely outruling the presence of an individual conscious. If I have to just be a part of the society, do I not lose my individual identity? So this is one area where he's criticized. Secondly, Weber. Now, as we have seen in the previous lecture, Weber was an interpretative social scientist, where he tried to strike a balance between the positivists and the completely subjective people. Now, Durkheim, being a hardcore positivist, was criticized by Weber by creating social sciences in an environment that it looked more like natural sciences, like physics, chemistry. I mean, basically compromising on the subjectivity that is there in human behavior. So this is largely about social facts. After this, there is a very important topic on division of labor. Now, according to Durkheim, he also wrote a book by this name, Division of Labor, where he talks about in detail. So according to Durkheim, division of labor is a very important social fact in a society. And this concept, however, was first used by Adam Smith. He said that as the societies get more industrialized, there is a need for greater coordination, and then there is of course the rising of specialization, which is in other words division of labor. Durkheim, however, takes a different view. He sees that when there is an increase in individualism, there is an increase in autonomy. And this leads to division of labor. And there is also a direct increase in division of labor when the autonomy increases. So in this term, that how people interact with themselves, etc., he talks about solidarity between people in changing scenarios. And he talks about two types of solidarity: mechanical solidarity, organic solidarity. Now, in mechanical, there is very less level of specialization and there is very less division of labor. Everyone is more or less very homogeneous. But as and when times advance, society becomes more industrialized, it shifts towards organic solidarity. In organic solidarity, everyone is more interdependent, but at the same time, individually skilled. Now, to give you an example, in let's say a footwear manufacturing company. There'll be the leather industry, there'll be the marketing industry, there'll be the packaging, etc. So no one, they work in silos, they are organic, they have their own level of specialization. But at the same time, they need to be interdependent on each other. A very good example of this can be our very own ministries in the central government, in the state governments. The MHRD works with other institute, other ministries so as to get a scheme going. The Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao is a joint venture of Ministry of Health, Ministry of Education, Ministry of Child and Women Development. So all the tri-sections work together to make it function. They have their individual specializations, but at the same time, they work in tandem. So, after having talked about the various types of solidarity, Durkheim explains what actually causes division of labor. So, he says, then when there is an increase in population, this is pretty obvious because the jobs happen to be the same, but then if someone has to get ahead of the race, he has to develop a niche skill. Then he says that if there is an increase in moral density. The moral density is basically when the interaction between people increases. So when you're working in a very diverse system and everyone is, you know, a master of some trade, you happen to interact and then the whole system gets going. And so when there is an increase in moral density, there is division of labor. And then lastly, he says, when there is an increase in mechanical density. The various aspects of industrialization, the technology, blah, blah. When everything on those side happens to increase, there it serves as a precursor to division of labor. Now, he further goes on to mention about three types of division of labor. First one is anomic. Now, let us say, if we talk about an industry, or let us say, you know, a factory for that matter. If, you know, the management happens to face suspension or the management falls out, the administration falls out, there'll be no regulation. In that case, it becomes an anomic division of labor. No one knows what to do. Everyone is doing whatever they want to do. There is absolutely complete chaos. This is anomic. Second is forced division of labor. Now, let us say, if you're working, if we take examples of, you know, let's say some forced or some abducted workers, you know, human trafficking and all those examples where you are regulated by a system which is too harsh. In that case, the division of labor happens to be very forced. And lastly, there is non-coordinated. Let us say I work in the army and then there is the navy, then the air force. If there is no coordination between the three, then in the times of war, I mean, even otherwise, there is going to be a lot of friction. There is no coordination. So despite having their own specialization, they are not able to contribute to the greater cause. So this basically are the three types of division of labor that Durkheim talks about. Now, of course, we come to my personal favorite part, is criticism. So, a hack, if I were to tell you, Durkheim was severely criticized by Malinowski. So, Malinowski was basically, it spells as M-A-L-I-N-O-W-S-K-I, Malinowski. He was basically a very renowned anthropologist, but in his research studies, where sociology has a considerable overlap, he did venture into the field of social sciences. So Malinowski basically says that Durkheim misunderstands division of labor as a sign of human progress. He thinks that just because, you know, people have become specialized, this doesn't mean that there has been a development in their cognitive ability. It's not that the technology has become very advanced. It's a wrong way of looking at things, according to Malinowski. And that's how he criticized Durkheim. And then finally, Lockwood says that You cannot confuse social integration with system integration. So in some of the case, he basically says that just because an industry or a factory is working and then there are people who are interacting with each other does not necessarily mean that they are interacting in the capacity of professionals. It just might happen that they are having a chit-chat about their personal life, about their personal well-being. So he says, do not misunderstand social integration to be system integration. A very valid point there. So this is basically how Durkheim explains division of labor as a social fact. Now we move on to the third topic, and a topic which actually would disturb my mother a lot when I would study when preparing. It's called suicide. I know. So it might intrigue you. But Durkheim again says that suicide is a social fact. It has externality, it can be generalized, and again, it has a constraint effect on you. So in case of suicide, basically Durkheim says, so let us understand it through line diagrams. Now let us say there is a society which has regulation. Now when the regulation levels are very high, in that case happens a fatalist suicide. For example, a slave society. They have no way but to commit suicide due to the factors which are highly regulating. Now let us say we have a society where the level of regulation is very low. In that case there is an egoistic suicide. An example of this can be during recessions, or let us say if you the very feeling of being unwanted and someone going through a lot of, I would say, professional ups downs because there has been a mismanagement. If we see farmer suicides happening merely because their loans have not been waived off, or maybe due remuneration has not been given to them, that would actually come unto egoistic suicide because the regulation level which is to be imposed by a superior authority is very low. Then second case comes due to integration. Now let us say you live in a community or in a society where the level of integration is very high. There you happen to commit altruistic suicide. By altruistic, you come across as hero and you come across as someone who has died for its people. An example to this could be suicide bombers who think that whatever they are doing is for the common good. Another example could be the lone wolf attacks that we see in the recent past. These people, they die themselves and they think that they are serving the good of their community. In this case, the integration with the society is very, very high. Now then we talk of... So here it's basically not egoistic, it is anomie, anomic suicide. Because there is an anomie, there is no regulation. Now then comes an egoistic suicide when the level of integration is actually very low. Now this happens when you feel depressed. Now let us say, you do not have anyone to talk to, there's absolutely no one, you're coming back from classes in Rajendranagar or wherever, you have absolutely no one to talk to. That's when, you feel really, someone might feel depressed. No, not that I'm encouraging any suicide or anything like that. But just to give you an example, when someone doesn't have anyone else to talk to or relate to, when his or her near and dear ones are not available, then it might lead to egoistic suicide. So these were the four types of suicide that Durkheim talked about. Now as you can say, in all of these things, he has basically pointed out to the social conditions responsible for an individual suicide. So how wrong, how far is he right in that? So when there are thinkers who happen to criticize him, so thinkers like Atkins, they criticize him saying that A, whatever the data that you have for suicide might not be correct because people tend to underreport it, governments tend to fudge it. So whatever data which was the basis of Durkheim's research on suicide might not have been correct. Furthermore, this is criticized saying that suicide is not a social fact. It is an individual phenomenon. Someone might do it owing to his or her own personal conditions and not solely because of the society. So that basically forms one of the reasons why Durkheim faced strong criticism. Now, apart from, so the two, three things that we have discussed, first, the umbrella topic of social facts, and the two social facts, division of labor and suicide. Now comes the third part, which shows Durkheim's nature as a functionalist. So as I had mentioned before, that as a functionalist, he saw utility in everything. Now when we talk of religion, Durkheim believed that religion had a very special role in the society. In a society, the very act of praying together creates collective effervescence, a very important keyword there. Collective effervescence, and this in turn binds the society together. So you see, all through Durkheim has this common underlying theme that it is the society which is greater than the individual. He does not really give importance to the individual identity. So for religion, he says that it serves the function of binding the society, because the act of praying together, the various rituals, they happen to create a collective effervescence atmosphere, which in turn leads to social development. In order to prove this, he basically studied the Arunta tribes in Australia. There he found a very primitive form of religion being practiced, which was totemism. From there, he formulated two concepts, sacred and profane. Now, sacred were those objects which otherwise might seem very normal but were revered in a certain society. And profane were the daily objects which were not supposed to be brought close to the place of worships, or which were not supposed to be used when you are worshipping. To give you an example, a banyan tree or any religious tree that we have can be considered sacred in the Indian society, but does not hold the same reverence when we talk of the West. So what might be sacred in one society might be just another object, whereas what might be profane in one society can be considered as sacred. So we do not go wearing our footwear when we visit a worshipping place, a worship area. That's largely because it's a profane object. We wear it everywhere. So it has to be kept separate from the sacred objects. And that is why Durkheim created this demarcation of sacred and profane. He further goes on to mention that you must study primitive societies when you want to study the religion. Now let's come back to the point that he sees utility in everything because he's a functionalist. So here also he says that only when you understand religion from a primitive form will you be able to comment on its most advanced form. So, I mean, if I was to remind you, in Weber, he did it just the opposite. He studied a very developed Protestant ethic society to understand as to how capitalism rose from it. Durkheim just does the opposite. He studies a very primitive society and then concludes that whatever the beliefs of one society can be, cannot be used or cannot be extrapolated onto other society. Now, this was heavily criticized by, again, whom? Our favorite anthropologist with an interest in social sciences, Malinowski. So, Malinowski says that Durkheim becomes too functionalist and too positivist when explaining something as abstract as religion. So Malinowski would say one thing very famously, that religion is used by the masses to relieve anxiety. I mean, what better example than, let us say, you know, your results, your UPSC results are slated, and then you go and visit a temple or maybe your place of worship. So you basically seek solace in the supernatural power when you believe that everything that you could do, you've possibly done, and it's no more in your reach. So Malinowski basically subscribed to the opinion that religion is very abstract, it cannot be explained, and it is something that human beings resort to when they are dealing with something where they want to release their anxiety. Now, this was pretty contrary to what Durkheim said. He said that, see, there is a sacred, there's a profane, you have those two separate brackets. Religion has a very important function of binding the society together and not relieving anxiety or anything else. So that's where the two differed, and we'll talk about Malinowski in detail when we talk of religion and society. But for the time being, this suffices. So those were largely the four topics that UPSC mandates us when reading Durkheim. To begin with, there has to be social facts, which Durkheim believes that is the subject matter of sociology. He lays down three conditions, how a fact can become a social fact. And then he talks about division of labor in his work under the same name. So division of labor he also sees as a social fact. He then also sees suicide as a social fact, wherein he explains four types of suicide depending on the level of regulation and integration in the society. And lastly, he talks about religion. Religion, he comes across as a functionalist, where he talks about religion playing a very important role in cementing the society when a community or a group of people perform the religious acts together. So that's basically about Durkheim. Now we take up the question paper for year 2016, sociology paper 1. So there is a question in 8b, 20 marks. How is Durkheim's theory of religion different from Max Weber's theory of religion? So as I had mentioned while I was explaining, that first of all, Durkheim was a functionalist. He saw religion playing a very important role. He said that it is religion which binds the people together. Secondly, whereas Weber, on the other hand, he just said that it was religion which led to the rise of capitalism. He did not see it as a utility. He just saw it in a cause and effect relationship. Furthermore, Durkheim studied a primitive society. He studied the Arunta tribe of Australia, which were a primitive society, whereas Weber studied a far matured Protestant society in Western Europe. Apart from that, we can also highlight that Durkheim believes somehow supported the various rituals that were supposed to be carried out because it created a collective effervescence, whereas Weber nowhere mentions anything of those sorts. He does not talk about rituals. He does not talk about sacred or profane. So if you see Weber's, or for that matter Durkheim's view, is a little primitive, is a little supernatural, is a little, I would say, ethereal, more spiritual, whereas Weber's view is a lot more practical. Another aspect where Durkheim differs from Weber is Durkheim does not talk of any economical aspect. He does not say that totemism or sacred and profane objects have a bearing on how a society transacts or how a society exchanges. But Weber very clearly says that it is the religious beliefs of the Protestant Christian which happens to lead to a capitalist society, a capitalist economic ecosystem. So those are largely the differences how Weber differs from Durkheim. And that brings us to the end of this video lecture. So keep revising, keep going through the video lectures, and at the same time, do keep a tab of all the keywords that I tell you. They are very important. And see you in the next lecture then. Bye-bye.